So, wenn dann alle sitzen, fangen wir an.
Okay, so let's start. Okay, good evening, women and men, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you to this panel, Women at the Peace Tables, and the question of what challenges do we have to master when it comes to combating sexualized war violence, especially with a focus on Syria. Oh, are we starting too early? No. Now, my name is Gitti Henschel. Until the end of September, this year, I was the director of the Gundert Werner Institute at the Heinrich Böll Foundation. And in this position, I organized many expert talks and events in the area of women, peace, and security. And now, I am free. I am a free woman. I am a pensioner, in other words. And I can decide what to do in the future. I will definitely continue to work in the German Women's Security Council on a voluntary basis. I co-founded this council back in 2003. Now, before I start in medias res, I have to apologize because in the agenda, we had a representative both of UN Women and of the Foreign Office. So these two women were announced here for the panel discussion. For different reasons, they unfortunately had to cancel their participation because in this very month, in the context of the celebrations of the implementation of UN Resolution 1325, on the 15th anniversary, there are quite a few events that are being organized and taking place, so they couldn't come to attend our conference, so the other panelists will have more time to speak a little longer, which is also quite beneficial. There is no plan, and there's also no readiness and no interest to involve women in peace negotiations. This is a conclusion that Malene Rees drew, Secretary General of the International Women's League for Peace and Freedom, WILP, of last November, where we organized another expert talk here at the Heinrich Böll Foundation. I think I have to stop, make sure that everybody can take a seat here. We have some vacant seats here in the front, if you'd like to come to the front. Madeleine Rees herself was a member of the delegation of women's organizations that tried to participate in negotiations to put an end to fights in Syria in vain because the special representative of the United Nations, Brahimi, did welcome the women there, but then he didn't listen to them, never mind include them in negotiations. As you know, negotiations failed, and we know that the war is continuing with even more brutality. This ignorance and the exclusion of women from the so-called male domain of security policy, it is still a male domain, although we have a female Minister of Defense and a female Federal Chancellor, as you might know, but it is still a male domain, and it has a long history, this exclusion. So it seems to be all the more absurd if you take a look at the findings and studies that have been conducted in the last 20 years. They have shown that whether they are mediators, negotiators, consultants, decision makers, whenever women participate in ceasefire or peace negotiations, the chance for an agreement is increasing. And increasing is also the chance for a sustainable conflict resolution, because we know that 5 years after the end of a war, conflicts flare up again. This finding was produced in 2000. That was the year when Resolution 1325 was passed. Yet it was too late at the time, and we can see the implications. At the time, then US President Bill Clinton said, after the failure of Camp David negotiations, if we had had women at Camp David, we would have achieved an agreement. Like Syrian women this year or today, peace policy active women from Israel and Palestine were excluded, the so-called Jerusalem link. And they had already developed cross-border conflict resolutions in their respective organizations in Israel and Palestine. And as we know, this conflict is escalating again even more. And it's not only this conflict, but if we take a look at the global situation, we can see that the number of violent conflicts and brutal wars in comparison to last year and in comparison to the years before that has reached a peak. And against the backdrop of the Ukrainian crisis and conflict, this conflict is coming closer to us here in Europe/Germany. Plus, the militarization of peace and security policy has increased also in Western states. Arms production and arms export has also increased, especially from and out of Germany. We can see examples in Iraq, Israel, in Turkey, and in Saudi Arabia even. And it's also well known that Germany is the third biggest arms exporter of the world. So in other words, wars and conflicts are fueled with German weapons. On the other hand, we are celebrating a year of women and peace policy achievements. It's the 100th anniversary of WILPF, the International Women's League for Peace and Security, the 20th anniversary of the Action Platform of Beijing that was celebrated in spring this year, and the Women's and Peace Policy event of this month is the 15th anniversary of UN Resolution 1325. That is the resolution that covers women, peace, and security issues, which is considered to be a milestone and a breakthrough in the area of women's and peace policy. It regulates the so-called four big P's for all member states, that is protection, the protection of women and girls in particular, protection from sexualized violence, especially in war times, and also in escape situations, prevention, the prevention of armed conflicts, that is, participation, so women at the peace tables, exclamation mark, a demand that we have put up many times. And it is said that better peace resolutions are possible whenever women are participating, and the so-called peace building. So the obligation of countries, of member states, that is, to launch peace building measures by integrating and including women. The fifth P has been added in the meantime. That is prosecution. So the legal and criminal prosecution of perpetrators, so to prosecute them after they had committed gender-based violence and sexualized violence during and after armed conflicts. On the occasion of the 15th anniversary on Resolution 1325, the UN Women Organization conducted a global study and presented a study on the implementation of UN Resolution 1325. And also in the context of other anniversaries, stock was taken, and you can say that there is a clear result, saying that due to the great commitment of human rights organizations, of many women, of peace women, thanks to their advocacy and lobby work, a whole package of normative standards and rules has been developed. So at the normative level, we women have achieved a lot. Everything is based on studies, analyses, experiences, findings that were included in all those documents, and monitoring and reporting systems have also been established. This especially holds true when it comes to combating sexualized war-based violence. There is a very differentiated set of rules, and what needs to be mentioned here is a catalog of measures that includes the so-called naming and shaming approach. According to that, all war-involved parties have to be listed that have committed sexualized violence. And this is supposed to be the basis for further measures such as sanctions. Furthermore, international tribunals and courts have recognized sexualized violence as a war crime and a crime against humanity. And there have been individual, way too few trials that have held those people accountable. And what is also important to mention and see is at the level of statements, up to high-ranking politicians like US Secretary of State John Kerry, one thing is clear for everybody. Women from civil society are particularly relevant when it comes to managing internal or cross-border crises and conflicts, and also when it comes to combating gender-based war-related violence and crimes. And since 2013, since the conference, this is supposed to be of highest priority. So that was the document and statement level. If we now take a look at concrete numbers and measures, we can see that the situation looks much more contradictory. The global study of UN Women of this year has produced those results, and it actually confirms what we have known from other studies. At the moment, we have 54 states. It's hardly more than a quarter of the UN member states that have their own national action plan in order to implement UN Resolution 1325. Germany passed and set up its own national action plan in 2012. This is something that the Women's Security Council had been fighting for since 2003. So you can see everything takes time. So since the adoption of UN Resolution 1325 back in 2000, there is reference made to women in 50% more of peace negotiations. At least women are mentioned there, but if you take a look at the numbers, it is only 27%, so a little bit more than a quarter. I don't know, maybe most recent numbers of 2014 make us hope. 4 in 6 peace negotiations took place where the United Nations was involved, and the entire complex of women, peace, and security was included. But it's not only the UN member states, but it's the United Nations itself that shows a clear delay when it comes to including women into the area of peace policy, also at highest level. So they are very late when it comes to implementing the resolution. I mean, we have seen, and we do see, high-ranking female executives, special ambassadors have been appointed, for instance. I don't know whether I should really like that, but since 2014, we have seen the first commander of a UN-led peacekeeping mission. This is a Norwegian general major, a woman who works in Cyprus, and we also have a special rapporteur and commissioner against sexualized violence in conflicts, who is a woman. But if you take a look at the numbers of women in the UN system as a whole, then the number is lower than 10%. Plus, the financial support of industrialized countries, but also of the United Nations and the EU for gender equality in peace and security policy, shows a total imbalance with regards to declarations and requirements. I'm not going to delve into detail and give you specific numbers, but let me tell you, according to an OECD study, when it comes to hard policy aspects in the area of peace and security, we are talking 2% of $10 trillion earmarked for women, peace, and security, which is actually a very small amount. Gender-based violence is considered to be a crime against humanity. It can be prosecuted as such, but you also have to see that the masterminds behind the entire system are hardly ever held accountable. We have seen a few examples of milestones where they were prosecuted, but unfortunately, this is still the exception to the rule. Having said that, when we take stock after 15 years of this UN resolution, the situation is rather ambiguous. On the one hand, we have this impressive set of rules. On the other hand, reality on the ground looks different and is rather sobering. All in all, male negotiators and mediators of conflict parties stay amongst themselves, and often it is old men who still stick to patriarchal traditions. And women at peace tables are an exception to the rule. And even worse, whether it is in Afghanistan or in Syria or in other war regions, warlords and war criminals often sit at the negotiating table. And international supporters or negotiators do not use their positions enough, see Brahimi, in order to make change happen in this situation. So women and their specific interests are discriminated against and neglected in those negotiations. Hypocritically spoken, I could also say that a huge machinery was created in order to implement UN Resolution 1325 in the last 15 years, and many women, also from feminist movements, have benefited from that and have done great jobs, and they also exert a certain influence, and they gained a certain status. They also set up a lot of expertise, but they also established themselves in a huge machinery of bureaucracy or expertocracy. For instance, gender mainstreaming, lobbying, gender trainings, monitoring, and evaluation. So it's a huge machinery that was created. But it wasn't really beneficial to the women on the ground. You can discuss money issues. Money has not always been used efficiently. Yesterday, Sabine Haag mentioned it in her keynote. She said, one side gets privileges, but that goes at the expense of the other side. This is definitely a thought that we should dwell on. When, in March this year, I went to New York and attended the Commission on the Status of Women session on the occasion of the implementation of the Action Platform of Beijing of 1995, it was impressive to see tens of thousands of women gathering there, giving a review, sort of. On the other hand, and that was then the discouragement of many activists, they criticized that there is a blown-up system that we have in the United Nations that is not really effective. And I also thought, if you took the money and funded grassroots organizations in the different regions, wouldn't that really make more sense to take such an approach and fund those organizations? I think we need to discuss all those issues. The former director of UN Women at an event of the predecessor organization sorry, UNIFEM, that is the predecessor organization of you and women, Joanne Sandler, she said, when women took to the streets to protest against mass rapes in the Congo in front of the UN representation and asked for support, what did we get? A gender advisor. And old feminists like Peggy Antrobus even put up the hypothesis many feminists got corrupted because they were included into the entire UN system. This concern or skepticism, i.e. that women were maybe included into the UN system too much, was uttered by different feminists when UN Resolution 1325 was passed in 2000. So there were other reservations and concerns against this resolution at the time, and one concern was that the resolution could be abused in order to justify military interventions, for instance. And I think if we take a look at the situation in Afghanistan or other conflict regions, we have to admit that those concerns were quite justified. On the other hand, the resolution contains contradictory requirements. On the one hand, it focuses on empowerment, on empowering women and their rights. But on the other hand, it also focuses on the protection of women and girls, especially when it comes to sexualized war violence. However, at the same time, general societal structures are excluded and not considered, which is a problem, because this sketches a one-sided and biased image of women. It is the perpetrator-victim scheme which is focused on the biological sex. Women are the victims that need to be protected. We have heard it already yesterday. And men are never considered to be possible victims of gender-based and sexualized war-driven violence. Like, women are never considered to be perpetrators or co-perpetrators. In the next resolutions on women, peace and security, 1860 and 1820, this is definitely improved. There's no doubt about it. Especially women and girls are exposed and threatened by sexualized violence in armed conflicts, also in the face of reconstruction in post-war societies. Mass rapes, violent displacement, and enslaving women as a war prey are supposed to humiliate and demoralize the enemies and increase the readiness to fight with own fighters. And we know that from the media, from television, those images, that is. At the moment, especially with regards to Syria, we have seen this in a very extreme way. We saw similar situations in the Congo, in Uganda, Sudan, former Yugoslavia. And this is sort of an endless list here. But what is not shown and broadcast on television, what is not mentioned either, is that it's also boys and girls who become victims of mass sexualized violence. The conflict researcher Dubravka Zarkov calls this the taboo in the taboo. And we heard this already in the expert talk this afternoon. This is a taboo issue that nobody can actually talk about, because this type of violence undermines traditional masculinity images. And men as victims, in general, contradict the myth of male power and the fact that they are not vulnerable. We know that armed conflicts and wars always have devastating implications, also on the civil population, the civilians, and the traumas have implications on future generations. They become even more extreme if people, men, women, kids, are exposed to sexualized violence. So these traumas have to be coped with, they have to be dealt with and discussed, because they are even more devastating if the victims are men, or boys because they are vulnerable for more violence in the future, and they might then become perpetrators again, because in order to prove that they are real men, they develop an extreme image of masculinity, that is the image of militarized masculinity, and their readiness to exercise violence again in order to defend themselves is extremely high and often escalates. And the spiral of violence is flared up. I mean, this is very theoretical. Of course, it comes down to the individual cases, but this is the general structure. So this means for the individual families, if husbands and men return, this results in domestic violence in many cases. So for women and kids, this is a huge problem. So combatants that return sometimes exercise domestic violence. So what do we do with all those findings is the question now. And how can we improve the situation? How can we make sure that progress is achieved? How can we include women, the grassroots organizations? How can we support them? What can we do, especially in Syria? How can we make sure that the situation becomes less dramatic? This is really a disaster that people have to escape from Syria in such great numbers, drown in the Mediterranean because they just want to escape this devastating situation. And I think we really have to bear in mind and understand what this really means for the people there. We have seen some pictures of the situation of women in Syria this afternoon. And when seeing those pictures, we know that we definitely have to do something and make progress. How can we also hold the warlords accountable? What needs to be done by the international community? What obligations does Germany have? What can we do together? I'm looking forward to our panel discussion now. And I'm looking forward to passing the mic to Barbara Unmüßig, who is going to chair this evening discussion. Barbara Unmüßig is one of the presidents of the Heinrich Böll Foundation. And she is committed in international justice issues. She started dealing with it back in 1983. You can read it in her biography on our website. And please read her biography. I'm not going to tell you all the impressive works that she has done and positions she has had. But again, she is one of the presidents of the Heinrich Böll Foundation. She has been a president since 2002, and she has always been committed to improving the situation in the area of women's rights, women's human rights, also from a gender perspective. She always dedicated her work to gender-related issues, gender perspectives. She has supported the Gunda Werner Institute in their endeavors all the time, and therefore I'm really pleased to pass the mic to you, Barbara.
Ja, liebe Gitti, ich möchte dir erstmal ganz, ganz herzlich danken.
Dear Gitti, thank you very, very much for your very knowledgeable presentation. It highlights what you have done for the Heinrich Böll Foundation in the field of gender and security. Over the past 15 years, you have accumulated a lot of knowledge, a lot of fighting power and spirit, and a lot of networking that you, Gitti, organized in the context of gender and security. You are a member of the Women's Security Council, and also when we bade farewell to you, I said that you have left behind a legacy that obliges, and I think that our conferences in the future will show that we work in the field of peace and security for women. We will fight for their rights to participate, and we do this all the more because we are an international foundation. We have 34 foreign offices, and we have many offices that we maintain in conflict regions in the Middle East, in Northern Africa, in South Asia, in Myanmar, wherever there are conflicts that play a big role. And this is what I stand for. definitely participation of women and their right to participation and human rights are a major goal in our work worldwide. So I would also like to welcome you personally to this panel discussion on women to the peace tables. And now I'm very happy that we can discuss this with our international panelists. We will use some of the examples that were already addressed by Gitti, namely the exclusion of women not only from peace talks, but also exclusion of women generally in the public perception. This is something that we experience in reporting on war in Syria and Iraq at the moment. Nobody takes account of the different gender perspectives. Nobody looks at how women and children are affected specifically. We also exclude women in our perception when women live in refugee camps. And the afternoon panel also clearly highlighted that whenever women and children reach us here in Germany, there are far too little women-specific services and programs for sheltering them. We do not protect women and children. We do not provide gender-specific services in their training, in their access to the job market. This was something we discussed this afternoon, and I can assure you that this is a gender perspective that we will take in order to look at what is happening to the women that have reached Germany, how can we improve their situation in Germany, and how do we take gender-specific contexts and perspectives seriously, and as women, how do we exert pressure so that this gender perspective then is translated into action? And we do not just pretend that we are going to ignore this. So taking the example of Syria and Iraq, we will discuss how women feel on the ground in the countries. And let me just talk about our work. We have an office in Beirut, and this office is very intensively working with refugees that reach Lebanon. We did a lot to document the personal stories and histories of women. Documentation, Ms. Davis will tell us about this, is a key prerequisite for being able to prosecute war criminals. Documentation is a prerequisite for being able to engage in prosecution. We help Syrians to organize this documentation. And especially, we want to document the situation of women. Women not only as victims, but also women that have a perspective for the future of their country. This is why we want to tell their stories. We have supported films that were made by Lebanese filmmakers. They portray women from Syria that left the country. So go to our website and look at the links to these films. We also supported a theater production in Lebanon, Antigone in Syria, where women exclusively tell about their stories, what made them escape from the country, and what they think about the future of Syria. So all of this is something that you can look up on our website, and you can also experience firsthand what we do in order to give women faces and voices, in order to document what they have experienced. This is a task that we take very seriously. In Syria and in Iraq, we are far away from a ceasefire or from peace talks. With the military intervention of Russia, we have reached a situation in which we know that the suffering of the Syrians that have stayed in the country is going to become even worse. Before starting with this complicated matter and start to discuss who should negotiate which ceasefire with whom, we, for instance, should discuss, and before we discuss this, whether we should negotiate with the war criminal Assad, before we do that, let me now introduce to you Gloria Atiba Davis. She is joining us from The Hague, and she is making us very happy, I think, because she will share her experiences with us. She is the head of the Gender and Children's Unit at the International Criminal Court in The Hague. And in her paper, she will tell us what the international instruments are that are geared towards protecting women and what the hurdles are in practice when it comes to prosecuting gender-based violence and war crimes. After that, we have the Women's Network representative who will speak about the women's situation in Syria, and she will tell us about how disappointed the Syrians are when it comes to the international community's activities. And after that, Ala Ali from the Amal Association from Erbil in Kurdistan will describe her take on things. She will describe her experience with Resolution 1325, and she will also speak about the barriers that prevent the National Action Plan in Iraq on 1325 from being implemented. So there will be a lot of talk tonight, and I would like to ask you for your patience. We will listen to three women, first of all, that have a lot of experience to share. So I hope that even after this long day, you have enough energy to listen to those three wonderful women. Gloria Atiba Davis started her professional career as a public prosecutor in her home country of Sierra Leone. And in 1997, she became a refugee herself because in 1997, there was a military coup that took place in Sierra Leone. So she escaped to London, and in 1998 she was applying for asylum there. And in the early noughties, she then worked in law firms in the United States, amongst others, and now she is the head of the Gender and Children's Unit at the ICC in The Hague. It is very difficult to find evidence on war crimes and on gender-based violence, and how difficult it is to investigate those cases is something she is going to explain to us. And she will also tell us about other instruments that we might be able to use in our work in order to protect women and have them participate. Ms. Davis, the floor is yours. A warm welcome to you. Once again, a warm welcome to you.
You can use the stair, but
good evening, everybody. I think I should first start by thanking the organizers of this meeting. I'd like to express the appreciation and gratitude of the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, Fatou Bensouda, for inviting her to participate at this meeting. The prosecutor, unfortunately, could not make it because of her busy schedule. And as has been said already, there are several events taking place around Resolution 1325. And so she had a prior invitation to attend one of those events. But she, however, sends her best wishes, and she hopes that we have very good discussions and a successful meeting. We know what it's like organizing a meeting like this, because it's not just conceiving the idea, but it also involves all the arrangements, logistical arrangements, identifying speakers. So we really appreciate the work of the Runda Werner Institute for putting this together. So I'm here to deputize the prosecutor, Fatou Bensouda. And we're all pleased at the court that we have a woman to head the office of the prosecutor. I am pleased to speak on her behalf, and to discuss with you all an issue which is of concern to the international community, but more so to women who bear the brunt of instability, conflict, and wars. And that is the issue of peace. I have been asked to talk on the topic, how international instruments and women's organizations can contribute to peace in the Middle East. Ladies and gentlemen, following World War II, the UN security model under the UN Security Council, with five permanent members having veto powers, was set up as a new institution of international peace and security. The underlying principle of this Security Council system was to ensure political consensus among the five permanent members to undertake collective action for international peace and security. As we all know, the UN Security Council Resolution 1325 of 2000 acknowledged both the impact of armed conflict on women and the importance of their participation in policy and decision making. The resolution further recognized that sexual violence constitutes a threat to international peace and security, and highlighted the need to take appropriate action to address it. 15 years have gone by since the adoption of this resolution, but unfortunately, sexual and gender-based crimes continue to affect millions around the world, victims being primarily women and girls, but also men and boys, with age, religion, or color being irrelevant factors. For the present discussion, it would have been ideal to reference specific provisions of different international instruments, which will help us to focus our attention to our individual and collective responsibility to create a peaceful environment and respect for human rights. But because of time, that would not be possible. I will therefore touch on a few, but deal in more detail with two instruments. We can go as far back as the Charter of the United Nations of 1945, which expressed the determination of countries to save succeeding generations from the brutalities of war and reaffirmed their faith in the fundamental human rights, in the dignity and worth of the human being, and in the equal rights of men and women of all nations. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948 recognized the inherent dignity and the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family as the foundation for freedom, justice, and peace in the world. The preamble to this declaration highlights the fact that disregard and contempt for human rights have resulted in barbarous acts which have outraged the conscience of mankind. This, unfortunately, we have witnessed in different regions and countries between 1945 and today, October 16, 2015. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights of 1967 emphasizes that enjoying civil and political freedom and freedom from fear of war can only be achieved if conditions are created whereby everyone can enjoy his or her civil and political rights, as well as his or her economic, social, and cultural rights. The Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, 1979, inter alia, stipulates that the welfare of the world and the cause of peace require the maximum participation of women on equal terms with men in all fields. Resolution 1325 emphasizes the participation of women in policy and decision making because it recognizes the significant role which women have played and can play in resolving conflict. The resolution also calls for the full participation of women in all aspects of peacemaking, including the negotiating of peace and ceasefire agreements. As we all know, apart from Resolution 1325, the UN Security Council has adopted 6 other resolutions on women, peace, and security, namely Resolutions 1820, 1888, 1889, 1960, 2106, and 2122. However, as I indicated earlier, I will put focus on only 2 international instruments, namely Resolutions 1825 and the Rome Statute, which established the International Criminal Court, to see how instruments can contribute to peace and freedom. Let me start with the Rome Statute, which was adopted in 1988 before UN Security Council Resolution 1820. The Rome Statute entered into force in 2002. The statute and the International Criminal Court represent the aspirations of the international community to achieve peace with justice and justice with peace. It represents a new legal framework that sets new parameters of relevance for resolving conflicts. The issue is no longer about whether we agree or disagree with the pursuit of justice in a moral or practical sense. It is the law that has been accepted by 123 state parties. State parties, by acceding to the Rome Statute, in effect, accept that justice is an integral part of conflict resolution and the creation of sustainable peace. The International Criminal Court has power to exercise jurisdiction over persons for the most serious crimes of international concern and is complementary to national jurisdictions. Based on the Rome Statute's clear legal criteria, the office can start investigations regarding war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide committed after July 2002 in the territory of or by nationals of the court states parties. The Rome Statute establishing the International Criminal Court added an independent and permanent justice component to the world's efforts to achieve peace and security. It offers a solution, creating global governance without a global government, but with international law and international criminal court. A new paradigm in international relations, utilizing law as a global tool to promote peace and international security, and to put an end to impunity, as well as prevent future crimes. Thus, an international instrument, the Rome Statute, set up an institution to contribute to peace. Since the court started operations in 2003, the Office of the Prosecutor has initiated investigations in 9 situations, namely Uganda, Libya, Democratic Republic of Congo, Kenya, Sudan, Cote d'Ivoire, Mali, and we have 2 investigations going on in the Central Africa Republic, one of which has led to the indictment and trial of Jean-Pierre Bemba. In addition to its investigations and prosecutions, the office is also engaged in preliminary examinations in Honduras, Afghanistan, Nigeria, Guinea, and Colombia, to name a few, with a view to determining whether there is a reasonable basis to proceed with an investigation. As some of you may know, last week, Fatou Bensouda, the prosecutor, filed an application to the pretrial chamber of the court requesting approval from the judges to start investigations in Georgia. The preliminary examination phase conducted by the Office of the Prosecutor is an information gathering process, and this permits the Office of the Prosecutor to determine matters of jurisdiction and admissibility. The true relevance of the Rome Statute, the work of the Office of the Prosecutor and the court as a whole, lie in the fact that by their global impact, they will contribute to maintaining peace by their deterrent effect, the prevention of violence, re-establish or maintain peace, and end impunity. The court's jurisdiction can be triggered by a referral by a state party or by the UN Security Council acting under Chapter 7 of the UN Charter, by a decision by the prosecutor using his or her proprimoto powers, or by a declaration of acceptance of the court's jurisdiction by a non-state party. Unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, without a UN Security Council referral or a declaration of acceptance, the court cannot intervene in situations like Syria, Yemen, or Sri Lanka, which are non-state parties of the court. The mere monitoring of a situation like those situations I mentioned that are under preliminary examination could deter further crimes from being committed. The announcement of an investigation could also have a preventive effect. The International Criminal Court, as the first permanent international court, has established high standards and good practices in several activities regarding the dispensation of justice, and these standards and practices could be replicated in domestic jurisdictions investigating and prosecuting crimes. The laws could be consistent with these standards. UN Resolution 1820 explicitly links sexual violence as a tactic of war with women, peace, and security issues, and highlights that sexual violence in conflict constitutes war crimes, crimes against humanity, or can be a constitutive act with respect to genocide. It also highlights certain facts linked to the mandate of the court. The resolution specifically recalls the inclusion of a range of sexual violence offenses in the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court and the statutes of ad hoc international criminal tribunals. The importance of this reference, in my view, is the realization by the international community that sexual violence is a threat to peace and security in the world. It is important for me at this juncture to highlight the position of Prosecutor Bensouda and the actions taken by her office regarding sexual and gender-based crimes. Upon assuming the office of prosecutor in 2012, Mrs. Bensouda elevated enhancing the investigation and prosecution of this category of crimes and crimes against children as a strategic goal of the office. One of the steps taken by the office to put words into action is the development of a policy on sexual and gender-based crimes, the first in the international arena. This policy was adopted in June last year and can be accessed from the court's website. Resolution 1820 also recognizes that states bear the primary responsibility to respect and ensure the human rights of the citizens, as well as all individuals within the territory as provided by relevant international laws. The Rome Statute encapsulates a similar notion. It asserts that the court's jurisdiction shall be complementary to that of national criminal jurisdictions. The International Criminal Court is therefore a court of last resort. The office takes a positive approach to the principle of complementarity, through which we seek to combine our efforts to prosecute those most responsible with those of national authorities conducting proceedings against other perpetrators. International instruments provide a common standard for all peoples of the world regarding obligations and responsibilities, acceptable behavior, and sometimes consequences. Relevant to our topic for discussion is the obligation to create the environment for human beings to live in peace, the responsibility for state and non-state actors to protect civilians and the international community as a whole to maintain peace. International instruments provide a framework to promote respect for human rights, or, like the Rome Statute, punish and act as a deterrent to perpetrators who abuse human rights and commit crimes which fall under the jurisdiction of the court. Let me now briefly address the second part of the topic. How can women's organizations contribute to peace in the Middle East? My presentation, however, is general and not limited to any region, though I will draw examples from specific countries. The UN Security Council Resolution 1820 recognized the important role of women in the prevention and resolution of conflicts and in peace building, and stressed the importance of their equal participation and full involvement in all efforts for the maintenance and promotion of peace and security, and the need to increase their role in decision making with regard to conflict prevention and resolution. Therefore, the topic begs the question, what role or roles should women's organizations play that would concretely contribute to achieving and maintaining peace? First of all, women should build on their role as mothers. As early as World War I, women and women's organizations and groups have mobilized and built momentum for peace And there are a range of options which women's organizations can continue to adopt to create and reestablish peace in their countries or regions. These range from bringing up children to respect human rights principles and values, to organizing demonstrations and protests against the conflict, as was done by nearly 1,200 women during the First World War. Women's organizations can also advocate for peace and reconstruction and for the development of a culture of peace, as has been done in Burundi, Niger, Somalia, and Angola. Women's organizations can also contribute to peace and freedom from several vantage points. Firstly, by building external networks. Following the example of Femme Africaine Solidaritaire, women's organizations can mobilize to foster and promote the inclusion of women in conflict prevention in their respective regions, including conflict prevention, management, and resolution. These organizations should form effective synergies, for example, like partnering with Nobel Women's Initiative, which, amongst other things, promotes the work of women's rights researchers, activists, and organizations that seek to target the root causes of violence. The Nobel Women's Initiative strives to develop a peaceful world free from all forms of violence and is committed to equality and to justice. Secondly, women's organizations could utilize local civil society groups to put pressure on warring factions to come to the peace negotiating table, as was done in Colombia, where pressure from women's groups promoted peace between President Andrés Pastrana and the guerrilla movement. In addition to bringing the parties to the table, the women's organizations developed a process to build consensus and created an agenda to address the root causes of conflicts, which they had identified as political, social, and economic exclusion. These two measures were part of their demand for peace. Another item in the package was the holding of a public forum during which women expressed their experiences of war, their apprehensions regarding the safety of their communities, and their motivations for peace. More importantly, they had an opportunity to confront both sides of the conflict, forcing them to acknowledge the atrocities their forces had committed against civilians, including wide-scale rape and sexual assault on women. Thirdly, women's organizations can also act as intermediaries between warring factions or between civilians and fighting forces. They can engage with fighting factions to build trust so that there would be open and genuine discussions at peace talks. They can lay the groundwork for meaningful dialogue. While others are calling for a military solution to end a conflict, women should call for a return to the negotiating table and for a non-violent resolution to conflict. Women's organizations should not cease in raising awareness of the human side to a conflict. These organizations can also raise awareness of the consequences of conflict, provoke policy, support training, advocate and benefit from lessons learned on implementation of the Women, Peace, and security agenda in other countries, and then adapt measures as is appropriate to their own region. We as women should also encourage and work with men to set up men-led initiatives. Yesterday, I joined the meeting late, and there were discussions about women and men. But I think when it comes to peace and security issues, we should realize that even though women suffer the brunt of it, that men do suffer as well. As has been mentioned before, men and boys, as well as women and girls, are victims of rape. Therefore, for us to have results that would benefit all of us, it is my view that we can encourage, and we should encourage, instead of taking tasks on our shoulders and try to promote peace and peace and sustainable development on ourselves, we should also encourage men to join us, because it's not a fight between men and women. Peace should be an environment that is created for men, women, boys, and girls to thrive and for each to maximize their potential. We had a great presentation this afternoon by Lubna, during which she explained some of the actions taken by her organization, Women Now for Development. Therefore, following that as a good example, I think women's organizations should no longer be passive. We should be proactive and see which particular areas we can really have a positive impact so that we can not only establish peace, but we can sustain peace so that all of us can thrive and reach our maximum potentials. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Gloria, for that presentation. And there is some progress in international law, definitely. Gitti referred to this as well. And the ICC is definitely part of that progress we can see in international law. Thank you very much for showing us the work of ICC and how do you look at how women can help to foster and enhance peace and freedom. Ich werde jetzt Jumana Saif vorstellen.
I'm now going to introduce Jumana Saif. She is a co-founder and the chairwoman of the Syrian Women Network. She is a Syrian journalist, she is a human rights activist, and her professional career started as a counsel for prisoners, amongst them also political prisoners. Since 2012, that is right after the beginning of the civil war in Syria, Jumana has been actively fighting for women's rights, and she does this together and in the context of the Syrian Women Network. The Syrian Women Network consists of many non-governmental organizations that have committed themselves to establishing gender equality, fostering women's rights. They deal with transitional justice issues, and they want to make sure that women participate in decision-making processes when it comes to the future of Syria. She is also active in the context of the Syrian feminist lobby. She has gained a lot of experience with how Syrian women have been excluded from approaches of diplomatic negotiations, approaches of ceasefire negotiations. Schumana, since 2013, has been living in Berlin. She is very active also here, and it's wonderful to have you here, Jumana. And as I said, you are going to tell us what you, in contrast all of those wonderful resolutions and Statute of Rome, you are rather disappointed of how little the international community has done in order to reduce the suffering in Syria. So I'm really looking forward to your presentation. It's wonderful to have you here. You have the floor.
مساء الخير.
Well, I'm not going to speak from the perspective of an expert tonight. It's not so far away from the crimes that have been committed by the Syrian regime in the past, and the question how the international community has been dealing with that. In Syria, we always say those who has been bitten by a snake once will never pull the rope again, and this is exactly what happened to my friend, who was very negative regarding the a negative attitude in the beginning. I would have thought that she is rather part of a gray zone, that she would be part of the ones that were silent. This is what we called them, the silent ones at the time. And my attitude then, well, was based on the fact that she comes from the city of Hama. Hama really suffered under the Syrian regime, and in discussions regarding her attitude towards the revolution, yeah, she was screaming at me. She said, you have no idea what this means. You have no idea what the Assad regime really implies. You have no idea what Assad is going to do to you. They will kill you. They are going to destroy you and your cities. They will build roads on your dead bodies. So what do you want to achieve with your revolution? The only thing that you will achieve is that the entire country will be destroyed, and you will be in the same situation as we were in Hama in 1982. And at the time I said, no, 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 you are wrong. You must be wrong. You're totally wrong. This is a different age. It was a totally different time back then. We now have internet. We have an exchange of ideas. We send satellites. Assad can't do that anymore. I mean, he can't repeat such a crime. Even if he wanted to commit such a crime, the international community would stop him. They would not allow him to do that. I mean, there will be the first ones to die, but their children will definitely live in peace and dignity, because if the international community sees that we are dying, they will punish Assad. My friend at the time was just laughing. She had this ironic laughter, and she said, you're really, really wrong. If you believe that the international community will interfere in order to rescue and save you, you are wrong. They might condemn Assad, but that's all. And probably after a while, they will turn their backs to you, will get tired. And if they see everything on television, then people will use their remote control and switch to a different channel and just forget you. Up until today, in the last 4 years, actually, I have been thinking of my friend time and again. I mean, now I was forced to leave Syria myself. She has stayed, and actually we don't have any contact anymore. We're not in touch, but then we met again because her son invited us to Barcelona a couple of months ago after a lot of sufferings, after many efforts. I became silent and I didn't know what to tell her. I actually wanted to tell her, please forgive me, you were right at the time, but I couldn't really say that, so I just remained silent. as if there had been a silent agreement between us so that we would both stay silent and not argue who had been right. So we never talked about this issue again. Now, the question is, why do we, the Syrians who took to the streets in order to fight the suppression of the regime, why did we dream of a different future? Why did we hope for the international community to help and rescue us? Our generation believes in the values of humanity that we have just heard about. So Ms. Davis was talking about those values. She was talking about human dignity. We heard a lot about human rights. We are a people that comes from a long-standing civilization. People say this is the beginning of civilization. It is the cradle of civilization, and we always opened our gates to those who escaped from other countries and were looking for a dignified life. This is part of our history. As a consequence, we were totally convinced of a good future because we study our geography. Syria is right in the heart of the world, we say. This brings me back to the city of Hama, the city where my friend comes from. It's actually a peaceful city in central Syria. In the city of Hama, a massacre was committed for 27 days. The Syrian army, if you can call it the Syrian army, under the leadership of Assad, committed this massacre for 27 days. 30 to 45,000 victims. We do not have any exact figures because people disappeared, and up until today we don't know where they are, what happened to them, whether they died or whether they live somewhere. This is what happened in Hama in 1982. These are old pictures. I just wanted to show them. I'm really sorry for showing you those sad pictures and photos of massacres, black and white photos. These are shocking photos that were taken in the past when those massacres happened. I didn't want to show them in order to shock you, especially as the day is ending. We got used to those pictures, yet it is still worrying and terrible to see those pictures. Now, the lesson of Hama of 1982 is a very shocking lesson for all Syrians. It was a lesson that showed us what reality looks like. I mean, we started to believe that this is what we have. For 30 years, nobody dared demand their rights. For 30 years, nobody dared raise their voices or do something. Whoever dared do something, whoever dared take to the streets based on their own initiatives, was arrested and thrown into prison for 10, 15, 20 years. And I'm not exaggerating, believe me. Thousands of young Syrian men spent more than 16 years in prison, and I have many friends who ended up in prison. 16 years in a Syrian prison based on a ruling that was rendered within 15 minutes. This is sort of the blossom of the Syrian youth. This is the heart of young people, and most of them spend their youth in prisons. This is the elite that dared say something. The others, the rest of society, fell into a state of silence and fear. Everything was prohibited. Initiatives were suppressed. Societal work, civilian work was prohibited. In order to clean a quarter or neighborhood, that was also prohibited. We lived like that for 30 years until the generation of today grew up, a generation that did not know this type of suppression anymore, this type of brutal suppression that is. And this generation then took to the streets. They grew up in the country and they wrote their slogans on the walls and they dared protest. And this is the start of the revolution. It started with young people, with young kids whose parents were arrested. Parents who wanted to protect their children. Others then took to the streets because they wanted to show solidarity, and they were also welcomed with shots. In the beginning, there were only light shootings, and then people were arrested, and people were tortured. The bigger the demonstrations became, the more people were arrested, and the more people were tortured in prisons. The goal was to suffocate the revolution. Let me remind you of May 2011. My father was arrested at a demonstration, and after that, after he was beaten with sticks and iron rods, during his transport to the prison, and later on, he told me about thousands of prisoners that were living in this prison. It's impossible to imagine what this looked like. These were huge halls, no longer cells, that were full of people that were arrested. He spent 10 days in prison and then he was released. And I remember how he was telling me, this revolution is not going to be suppressed. This people doesn't allow for it to be suppressed. He talked to everybody and he didn't see or express any regret. Nobody regretted that he was in prison and that he was participating in this revolution. They were tortured, they were beaten, but this made them even stronger in their beliefs. So they said, this regime needs to be eliminated. We have to do and manage this with our own hands, because the way they treat us shows us that we have to do something against this regime. We have to make sure that our kids can lead a life in dignity without being humiliated, without being arrested and tortured, a life that is based on the freedom of opinion. Some arrests and some tortures after all these events, after these peaceful demonstrations, I mean, the number gradually increased. More and more people took to the streets, and the more killings were committed by the regime, the more people took to the streets. Demonstrations continued. With the exception of the city of Hama, there were no demonstrations in the beginning. Nobody took to the streets in the beginning. And one day, the inhabitants of the city of Hama heard that the American and Russian ambassadors were in the city. Then they took to the streets. They left their homes. Almost all inhabitants of the city took to the streets. This is a picture of the city of Hama. When the American and Russian ambassadors visited the city, they left their homes because they had the impression that these men could protect them, that there was an international community out there that would protect them from this regime. People had the impression that somebody was listening to them. This is why they took to the streets. They were holding olive branches, and this was a symbol of the regime. They were also holding the American flag. And this was a way to tell the regime, we are now turning to the American enemy after this regime has suppressed us for 30 to 40 years. And then the regime started committing massacres. Kids were slaughtered in the city of Hola, in their homes. When sleeping, they were slaughtered and the international community didn't do anything. I mean, there were some condemnations, but nothing actually happened. The international community didn't do anything. People were demonstrating, were saying, you need to protect us. They were demanding international protection. Everywhere, all over Syria, huge demonstrations took place. 70 demonstrations on one day alone, and they were all demanding international protection. The next day, the German ambassador visited, the American and the Danish ambassadors and the French ambassador visited, and they participated in the funerals of Ria Mata. They expressed their condolences to the family of this person who died. They carried water and flowers to his friends, and they also offered something to the army. The army tried to suppress the demonstration, and he died during torture after he had been arrested. And then he was buried before he was shown to his family. Those five ambassadors plus the Japanese ambassador were attending this funeral. They expressed their condolences to his family, and that was also published on social networks. And people then again thought that the international community would be there, that the respective countries were represented, and people thought, okay, we are not alone. They will not allow for a further suppression by the regime, but brutality and cruelty and massacres continued, and they repeated, and nobody really did anything against that. And then the regime used even chemical weapons, especially in Ghouta, in the area around Damascus. 1,500 casualties. We are talking about martyrs in Arabic, so about 1,500 killed people, mostly children and women, were killed as a consequence of the use of chemical weapons. They couldn't be rescued. Most kids died while sleeping. Their families weren't even able to bring them to a hospital. These are the besieged areas where there are no institutions whatsoever. Everything that happened was that the international community and President Obama started talking about red lines that have been exceeded. President Obama threatened to use military means, and then we again said, okay, now this is the end of the regime. The use of chemical weapons against civilians. People were waiting for something, but what happened afterwards is something that everybody knows. There was a deal. This is what we call it in Syria. It's an ironic deal. That is the chemical weapons deal. A criminal using chemical weapons that are internationally banned against civilians in order to kill civilians, and then you tell him, stay where you are, and then you give green light to the regime. Stay where you are, stay who you are, and just give us the weapons. And in fact, the regime understood that this is green light. They handed over their chemical weapons, although they were reluctant at first. But in the end, they gave them away, but then they continued their killings and massacres without chemical weapons, of course. So the chemical weapons were handed in, but the regime is a very smart one in Syria. So it knew exactly how to find other ways and use different means, and then they used the so-called barrel bombs. This is an excellent Syrian invention, very cheap to produce and very good outcomes, so to speak, when it comes to the radius and when it comes to the number of victims. This is what the regime does when it comes to throwing barrel bombs on civilians. Since 2012, these bombs have been thrown on civilians in Syria. And this is the power and force of those barrel bombs. So barrel bombs are basically barrels that are filled with nails and metal splinters and with explosives. And then those bombs are thrown out of an airplane. They explode then on the ground. They have a destruction radius of 250 meters. There's a lot of pressure, and they are devastating. The fire is devastating. It is a means of destruction. For 2 years, Syrians have been exposed to those barrel bombs, but the international community is silent. Here are some statistics of the 20th of October 2014 until the 20th of June 2015. So within 8 months, we have seen 21,173 airstrikes committed by the Syrian Air Force, 11,324 explosive barrels or barrel bombs were thrown on vulnerable civilians in Syria. That is 47 barrel bombs per day. That is the Syrian regime. And it is well known that France tabled a resolution draft against those barrel bombs, but unfortunately, France has not been successful so far. The resolution should have been passed by the Security Council in the last session period, but unfortunately, the Russian veto and the Russian attitude changed that. We have seen 4 Russian and Chinese vetoes, so no resolution can be successful. Also, the resolutions that were passed and adopted by the UN Security Council, 242, 243, 259, have never been implemented, starting with the 6-point plan and the Kofi Annan plan. Nothing has changed anything. Things just get worse and worse. The number of casualties and injured people is rising every day. Also, Resolution 2139 that regulates the import of humanitarian aid could not be implemented either. So all resolutions of the UN Security Council are non-binding. And there are no sanctions. These are just resolutions that are adopted and nothing follows. That was it. Nothing happens afterwards. When talking about international resolutions, I also have to talk about Resolution 1352, and Gloria already talked about this resolution. She was talking about the prevention and protection of women. So this is UN Resolution 1325. In this resolution, it is about the responsibility of all parties. Those who commit war crimes and genocide have to be held accountable and prosecuted. Women are exposed to sexualized violence in different ways, to a great extent, during wars especially. And I also have to mention the last report that was published last January and produced by Ms. Pengora in April. She visited Syria and she met the director of the Secret Service, and then she traveled to Iraq, Jordan, and Lebanon. And Ms. Pengora declared at a press conference that the history of rapes on the battlefield, or that the story is actually driven and characterized by suppression, that people do not want to talk about that. Us Syrian women say, well, you, Ms. Pengora, know exactly what the situation is. You know that people always deny things. You know what the regime has done to people who have admitted it. You talk to those women. You listen to those women. You heard what was done to those women in those national prisons. Why didn't you, as a historical document, mention this in your report so that we can hold perpetrators accountable in the future? All those crimes, all those violations that have been committed in Syria, this is part of organized policies. There is a systematic crime committed by the regime. Systematic rapes are committed by the regime. This is part of an entire system. But Ms. Pingora did not mention that in a single word in her report. She only mentioned the crimes committed by the IS. I mean, IS does commit crimes in public with a lot of media coverage in order to draw attention on their crimes, but many more crimes, hundreds of thousands of crimes, are committed by the regime behind the doors, behind closed doors. And nobody pays attention to that. And despite all those eyewitness reports that Ms. Pingora was listening to, no word is mentioned in her report. At the beginning of this month, I had the opportunity to meet Ms. Pingora personally, and I asked her about it. And then she said to me, well, I wrote down everything that I have seen and heard about. And then she talked about the Statute of Rome, and she said that the governments didn't cooperate and that the governments didn't want to sign the respective resolution, that they were against the respective activities, that they didn't want to sign the Statute of Rome. And then I asked her, Ms. Pingora, how should we punish the perpetrators if governments are the perpetrators themselves? If it is the government that organizes and commits those crimes in their buildings by involving their civil servants? And then she said, well, then go out and become active and support mobilization and try to make sure that your government signs the Statute of Rome. That was her response. Voila. There is one Syrian woman that I know very well. She was imprisoned twice, and she was sexually abused by the guardians in prison. And she also met many other women who experienced similar things. She's a very courageous woman, and she is maybe one of the very few ex-prisoners who talk about what they have experienced. You know exactly how difficult it is to talk about those crimes, especially in our societies. Nevertheless, she was ready to talk with Ms. Pingora. And after her report had been published, I asked my friend what she thinks about this report. She says, well, maybe someday we will be in a situation where everything that I have just said is written down, where our witness reports have a certain value. But it seems that nowadays our reports and our testimonies are of no use and of no value whatsoever. And then she said, but I'm actually not surprised by this report because I didn't have any hope in the international community and I don't have any illusions left whatsoever. This is unfortunately the situation of Syrians. You will know that Ola and other raped women, whenever they give testimony, cannot sleep for many nights. They need tranquilizers in order to be able to sleep at all, in order to suppress their terrible memories. You might imagine how much Ola was disappointed, and all other women that Ms. Pingora also met. Well, this is our experience with the international community, and what is so upsetting about it is that after everything that the Syrian people has done and the price that it has paid and all those numbers, I mean, they are documented, and the numbers of casualties, I mean, these are well known to the international community. More than 200,000 people that were killed, and these are rather lower estimates. And then you can break it down to how many people are murdered every hour. So this is our history. After all the sufferings that the Syrian people had to go through, after everything that the people has done, it is now forgotten as a people that just wanted to defend its dignity. And now it is seen as a country that has produced so many refugees. And it is even more sad that we hear certain explanations saying that Assad should be included in future negotiations in order to fight terrorism. You have to know that if Assad wasn't there, there would be no terrorism in Syria whatsoever. Because one reason is that he passed an amnesty against more than 1,000 criminals that he released from his prisons, well-known terrorists, serious criminals, while he at the same time never released a peaceful demonstrator from prison. If you gave the Syrian people two alternatives, either terrorism or Assad, I mean, then it is totally unfair. We are entitled, we have the right to pursuing a third alternative, and that is democracy. Friends, in our country, well, we fought for an end to suppression. We took to the streets peacefully in order to protect our rights and the rights of everybody else. We didn't want to become refugees, and we do not want to remain refugees forever. I don't like the term refugee anyways. Of course, I'm very grateful to the German government and to the German people and also to other governments and peoples who have opened their doors to the Syrian refugees. We still believe in justice. We believe in freedom and peace. And we believe in peace, not in any kind of peace, but in just and fair peace that can only be achieved once Assad has gone, who has violated international law on all fronts. This is a basic requirement for peace. Without that, we can never achieve peace. And despite all this frustration and those disappointments, we are pulling our strengths together, either individually or collectively in organizations, in order to defend our cause. We still believe in a free and peaceful civilian and democratic Syria. And we call upon the conscience of the international community. We call upon them to raise their voice and to give us our dreams back. We are entitled to live in peace and justice like all other nations in this world. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Jumana. Jumana, thank you very much for the very touching. So once more, thank you very much for these touching insights, for the experiences that you shared. With Alia Ali, we have a second representative from the region, a woman from the region that for many years has been experiencing what it means to live under conditions of war. Iraq has been a place of conflict for many decades, frequently, and we tend to forget this, how many wars Iraq has seen and how much the population has suffered. Syria accepted many Iraqi refugees for many years. Let me also introduce Ala Ali briefly. For 17 years, she has been working with women's groups in Erbil. This is in Iraqi Kurdistan. She is a specialist in peace building and conflict analyses, and she is also a member of the Amal Association, which is an association that is comprising many Iraqi groups. And they want one thing. They want to give Iraqi women and men a life in dignity, a good life beyond religion, beyond ethnic groups, or beyond gender. Ala Ali, for many years, has been active in counseling in the field of trauma management and conflict management, the UNDP, the development program of the United Nations, was also counseled by her. She also does peace counseling, and this now brings us to the topic of tonight. She has a lot of experience with what it means to have a National Action Plan 1325 and to develop it for Iraq. 1325 is the United Nations resolution that especially enables women to participate for peace, participation, and reconstruction are part of this. And she has quite some experience with what can happen to such an action plan, what the hurdles are, what the barriers are when it comes to implement this plan currently under the conditions of civil war in Iraq. So, Ala Aili, I'm very happy that you are here, that you were here this afternoon already for the expert discussion. So she will briefly once again describe her experiences. And after that, I promise this to you, admittedly, this is a long night. I will immediately open the discussion to the floor so that you can ask your questions to the three panelists. Ali, you have the floor.
Okay, good evening. I have to admit it's very hard to have a speech or presentation after what Jumana mentioned. It's heartbreaking, actually. But did she remind me with what we went through in Iraq? Either it was several wars with Iran, Kuwait, internal war, and also sanctions, and above all of that, Saddam's regime practicing against all Kurds, Shia, minorities, almost everyone who against him. My focus of this 5-10 minutes, it will be on 1325 and Iraq experience, including Kurdistan region with 1325. Actually, we do believe the Iraqi women movements and Iraqi women organizations that if you want to achieve a sustainable peace in Iraq, which is an important part or important country in the Middle East, we have to start to implement our National Action Plan of 1325. As I mentioned in the afternoon session, Iraq is the first country in the Arab region who adopted the National Action Plan in April 2014. But unfortunately, there is no any allocation for fund for 1325 by the Iraqi government or the international community to implement 1325. Also, we have, because of the current circumstances, we have an emergency plan as well, and it's adopted again by the government in May 2015 with no allocating fund or resources for implementing the emergency plan, which is really needed, especially in the current situation, because the emergency plan is focusing on IDPs, women and girls, and also the women, the returnees women, to the very few liberated area from ISIS, that we hope the women have an active role in building sustainable peace and involved in the reconciliation process in the liberated area. Here I will focus on the National Action Plan panels, or let us say pillars, that the Iraqi network, Iraqi Women Network, was part of drafting this plan in collaboration with the different international bodies and the government. Also, they were part of it, especially the Women Ministry of Women Affairs, that unfortunately it's counseled or resolved this ministry by the government in August. So we have no national mechanism for implementing this, the process of the National Action Plan and the Emergency Plan. We are focusing on four elements, which is participation, protection, advocating, and also allocating financial and human resources. In these four elements, I will focus on the challenge mainly, and where is our challenge in regards to each of these points. In the element of participation, actually women, Iraqi women, they have almost no any participation in the reconciliation process. She is not part of the transitional justice process or the reconciliation process. She is not participating in the peace process. However, we don't have a well-organized peace process in Iraq because we don't have a peace strategy. And the justification, we are a male-dominated community or society, and their justification is we don't have experts women that can be part of the peace process or reconciliation process. While, I mean, I have a clear data that we have no male experts in the peace. This is the reality. I'm the first woman, I got a degree in peace building. We have one Kurdish male, he has a degree and he just finished after I got my degree. No any male in the Arab part of Iraq and even in the Kurdish part of Iraq have a degree. So this is really, for us, it's a silly justification. She cannot be part of the reconciliation or the peace processes. However, request from the international community, please, we need to build the capacity of Iraqi and young girl Iraqi to have an academic degree in peace and leadership skills, because we need really to have active participation in the peace process in Iraq. Concerning protection, and this is linked, of course, to the legal framework. However, we have a very few good laws, like the anti-domestic violence law in Kurdistan and the anti-domestic violence law also in Iraq, which is still not approved, issued by the government. Both they are a good law, but there's no implementation of these laws. We don't have a complementary documents supporting these law, and there is many obstacle for implementing the laws. Norm culture is really a big challenge for implementing the laws, and actually the criminals of gender-based violence and sexual gender-based violence, they never bring them to justice because there's no implementation of law. So this is really a big challenge also for us and for the women activists and the women organization, and we have a lot of programs concerning protection in the National Action Plan and also in the emergency plan specifically for the women IDPs and how they get gender-based violence and sexual gender violence crimes, especially in camps and off camps also. The third element is about advocating, how we can have a strong advocacy and lobbying to implement the National Action Plan, not only on a national level, but on international level also. We need their support, and we need them to put a pressure on the government, on the decision makers, to implement the law. Also, as I mentioned, we are a male-dominated society. Usually, especially in ML Association, we are focusing on women and youth. And youth and children, they are really our focus when we build the capacity and try to advocate for women's rights and women's rights principles, because we believe the change come from educating children and youth. And we have a lot of experience how that affected on youth and children to be more gender sensitive and gender oriented if we started from education, from schools, and also through our youth programs and activities and children as well. And the last element is the financial and human resources. As I mentioned, one of the big obstacles for us is there's no any financial allocating for the National Action Plan and the emergency plan, neither from the government nor from the international community. So this is really is urgent, especially for the emergency plan. For the human resources, we have really a good local expert. But again, I will focus on two issues, which is the trauma and psychosocial support experts, and also the peace building experts. We wish the international community focus on building the academic, skills of Iraqi women and girls. In these two fields, we need a program scholarship to focus on that, because it's really very expensive if women and girls, if they decide to study abroad and specialize in these two fields. In Iraq, the public and even the private universities, they don't have these specialization. Do I have a time to focus on? Okay, and I would. Okay, so maybe it comes from that question. I would also like to highlight the role of UN. Because my friends and colleagues, they mentioned on their negative role, actually. And we don't see any positive role of the UN agencies. Especially, I will focus on the UN women. And they have really to reframe their strategy, their policies. My experience with the UN women in Iraq, they have to really go through that. They have to think of partnershiping the women NGOs, because they want to see impacts, they want to see results for their work. If they continue with this strategy, they will never see any result and impact. They will never be able to apply their objectives and roles, which is which will stay only what we say like a slogan for them. And we try to mention this and advise the UN Women Representative in Iraq, but unfortunately there is no change so far.
Okay. Perfect, Ali. And thank you very much to give us your insight, and you definitely ended up with a serious issue. How far the UN is really able, and UN women in especially, is able to support you. I think some people here in the room did listen carefully, I'm sure, about this. It confirms a bit what Gitti said at the beginning, that you have that experts coming in but not acknowledging the local knowledge, and this is true for many, many other countries as well. I would like to ask you a question. Since you are so familiar with conflict resolution, conflict prevention, undergoing conflict, do you have certain recommendations to a woman like Rumana? What can they learn from your experience? Is there any advice you would like to give?
According to my simple knowledge, actually each area, they have their own specific conditions and situation and causes for the conflict. So and this is really a big issue. Not only in Syria and Iraq, in the Arab region, there is no conflict assessment studies done by the local experts, unfortunately. I was the first person did a conflict analysis study for Anbar and Nineveh. So I would highly encourage the Syrian women, they have to focus on research studies because this is really essential. You cannot never build any program, any progress, if you don't have a scientific studies that shows you what's the cause of conflict. It was very strange for me that Nineveh and Anbar, both are Sunni province, both are Iraqi province. It's totally different in content, in the details of the cause of conflict in Nineveh and Anbar. So how comes to other country, even if it's a neighboring country? So studies and research.
Okay, ich habe Ihnen versprochen, auch an.
So I promise to you also, in view of the late hour of the day, that you are now allowed to ask questions, and you can also maybe comment on this, but please don't give your own co-presentation now, if possible. The microphone will travel to you. You have to speak into the mic because you already realized how many languages are spoken here around us. So please do let me know if you wish to take the floor and then also indicate who you are asking your question to. Is there anyone who would like to take the floor? Is there anyone who would like to ask a question? Thank you very much, Birgit Lohse, Institute of Trans-Sustainability Studies in Potsdam. Let me start. I have a question to the first speaker. Gitti Henschel? No, Ms. Davis. A question to Gloria Atiba Davis. You mentioned a couple of examples. And you mentioned a number of countries. You referenced them as examples, and it was not really clear to me whether these were, if this was concerning general investigations or if this was particularly to do with the situation of women in those countries. Maybe you could make this a bit clearer. Yes, I would also like to collect a couple of questions first. If there are no other questions, though, then I would like to ask Ms. Davis to answer the question that was posed to her.
Did you gave the examples where ICC prosecutes? Okay. Are they as gender-specific or more general ones?
I gave examples.
Sorry, the question is repeated in English by Barbara right now.
Sorry. The first example was countries where we've had prosecutions, okay, and I named 9 countries. And the second example I gave was examples of countries where women have formed like pressure groups to enable peace negotiations. And for that second example, I named Angola, Burundi, and Niger. Is that clear now? Yeah.
Gibt es gerne.
As well, what kind of punishments are there for people who are prosecuted? Like, what happens to them? And have there been many prosecuted? And my second question is to Ms. Saif. I would like to know what you would have the international community do. Would you have liked a military intervention, or what would have been or is your wish for the international community to do?
Okay.
Ah, da ist noch eine dritte Frage.
There is another third question over there.
I would like to thank each of the panelists for very informative and moving talks. And I was interested generally because in the beginning the possible role of Germany was also discussed. And as Ms. Davies had presented, that the ICC at this point cannot intervene. I was therefore wondering what a possible role of universal jurisdiction could be. So in that sense, a possible role for Germany, but I'm not too sure who to direct the question to. So yeah, I was just interested in that.
Okay, gibt's jetzt noch einen?
Are there one or two more claims to the floor? Otherwise, I will close this round.
I'd like to ask Ms. Gloria Atiba Davies, what prevent the ICC to take its job or maybe to judge the criminal who are documented to be guilty? are there any superior maybe intervention against your job in ICC? Thank you.
Okay, since the most questions went to you, I would like to ask you.
The first question relates to the number of trials and prosecutions that we've had so far. The very first case that was tried at the ICC was the case against Thomas Diallo Lubanga, who was the commander of one of the rebel forces in the DRC. And for that particular case, we only charged for offenses relating to children. He was charged with enlisting, recruiting, and conscripting children to participate actively in hostilities. And he was found guilty. He appealed, the sentence was confirmed, and he's now serving sentence. At the ICC, we can the judges can impose different types of sentences, stemming from starting from fines to life imprisonment. The only sentence that we do not have is the death penalty. So anything in between, yes, can be imposed on a, on an accused person. We've also had another case emanating from the DRC, the case against Gujulo and Taganda. Katanga. Gujulo was, his case was dropped on technical grounds, and Katanga was convicted on some of the charges. We had a case in Kenya, in fact, two cases in Kenya. One was against Ruto, who is the vice president in Kenya, and the other case is Kenyatta. We had to drop the case against Kenyatta because we were blocked on all fronts by the government of Kenya. They just refused to give us access to evidence for crimes like sexual violence, even for us to get access to medical information of victims who reported at the hospital. It was a no-go. We just could not make any headway. And the other issue with that particular case is that victims were very, very scared. They were intimidated. There were some cases of disappearance. There was witness interference. So we just could not complete the investigation. And so we had no choice because we asked for adjournment several times. We brought to the attention of the chambers the difficulties that we were encountering. The chambers made certain orders, and they were not complied with. So we had no alternative but to drop that case. But the case against the vice president and another accused person, that one is currently going on. We also have a case against Bosco Ntaganda, also emanating from the DRC, and the prosecution is currently leading evidence. The case against Jean-Pierre Bemba, which emanates from the Central African Republic, we're waiting for a decision, even though Pierre Bemba comes from DRC, but he was charged for crimes that were committed in the Central African Republic, because according to our investigation, everything points to the responsibility of Jean-Pierre Bemba, because it was his men who went to CAR to help Patassi, and in the process, they committed crimes against humanity and war crimes. We are far advanced in the investigations against the Lord's Resistance Army in northern Uganda. We have active investigations going on now against Dominic Ongwen, and we have completed much of the investigations regarding Connie, so we're waiting for him to be arrested. We also have a case against Laurent Gbagbo emanating from the Ivory Coast, Cote d'Ivoire. He was the former president, and we charged him for crimes that were committed during the post-election violence. So those are ongoing cases. We have, I'm not sure how much you follow the activities in the ICC. About 3 weeks, 2.5, 3 weeks ago, we also had an accused person from Mali who is now at the court. He's in prison in Scheveningen. We have cases emanating from Darfur, and we charged even the president, al-Bashir, is one of the accused persons that we're waiting to be arrested. We're waiting for exactly. You see, this is, you know, where we bring in the international community as well, because the ICC does not have any armed forces, we don't have any police force, and so we depend on cooperation from the state parties and, you know, governments to effect the arrests, and also to grant requests that we make to them regarding cooperation, because we cannot do that ourselves. Another question that was asked was, what prevents the ICC from taking up cases? As I mentioned in my presentation, the ICC's jurisdiction is triggered either by a referral from the state itself, from the UN Security Council, or the prosecutor using his or her proprio motu powers to start a case, and for that she would need approval. For a situation like Syria and Yemen, we cannot initiate investigations using our proprio motu powers because those countries are not signatories to the ICC. Yes, so we either need a referral from the UN Security Council, or the country itself, though it's not a state powers, it accepts the jurisdiction of the court. We have what we call a declaration of acceptance. So once they accept that, then we can initiate an investigation. But without that, our jurisdiction is not triggered, unfortunately. So it's either to push the UN Security Council, because the other option, getting the country to accept the jurisdiction of the court, I can't see that happening. So that's where we are.
Yeah, and at the Security Council, all the Syrian resolution are failing, yeah, because of the power play of Russia and of other international players. And just what I got to know from our office in South Africa is even considering to withdraw from ICC after that scandal that happened when they want to arrest, or didn't arrest, Letim Eskem Bashir from Sudan. Da war die große Frage an Jumana.
There was a big question to Jumana. What would be your wish to the international community? Should the international community intervene? And you took a clear position on this. Now there is a big dispute whether negotiations should be started anyway with Assad. And I would like to hear from your perspective on this.
بالبداية الشعب السوري أبدا ولا مرة طلب إنه تدخل.
Well, an international intervention by ground troops was never requested. What was requested first of all was for the besieged regions to create safe corridors so that assistance can reach the besieged regions, assistance and aid for those people who starve there and who suffer in the region. Before that, a no-fly zone was requested because the people in Syria are killed by airstrikes and by barrel bombs. No-fly zones do not cost a lot of money to the big states and the international community, and all the money that has already been spent on the coalitions and alliances and the airstrikes against the IS positions and terrorism were much more expensive. And even so, the Islamic State is still further spreading. And this, of course, triggers many questions, because the Islamic State can not only spread, it even fought its way to Palmyra, to this historic site, 250 kilometers across the entirely empty, deserted desert region. And they would have been completely exposed and would have been vulnerable for airstrikes, but nobody from the regime, nobody from the coalition attacked them. And this is really something that provokes many questions. And we cannot really answer this. We cannot really explain this. Actually, the request was a no-fly zone, or at least to install airstrike defense so that at least the helicopters and planes that were killing civilians could be taken down. But unfortunately, this request was not fulfilled. The international community should have exerted some pressure on Azat in order to force him to resign so that negotiations could have been taken up. Of course, we cannot say that countries like America or the problem is a problem that has to do with the United States and Russia. And at the United Nations summit, all the world looked at this summit, paid attention to it, and the ambassadors of the European countries also expected a solution, but still no solution was found. So I would hope that Merkel and Germany, as an important and very influential country in Europe, could contribute through their policies. Germany also has strong relations to Russia with Putin, so Germany and Merkel can maybe exert some pressure, use their influence so that everybody returns to the negotiation table. We want a peaceful negotiating solution. We want to achieve peace. Everybody agrees on this. But at the end of the day, this has to happen without Assad, because he is a criminal. Thank you.
Thank you, Jumana. Thank you again for this very clear statement. We have seen that there is a proxy war going on between Russia and the United States. Russia is bombarding mainly the areas of the Free Syrian Army. The Russians have announced that they will use up to 100 attacks, or make 200 attacks per day, and I have said already that this is going to increase the suffering of the Syrians even more. The militias, the pro-Americans, asked the Americans to supply them with air defense missiles, and I am totally stunned and shocked to see how difficult it is to negotiate a ceasefire. It will take a long, long time until such a ceasefire will have been achieved, I'm afraid. We can try to join forces and understand the complex situation, and we in the Heinrich Böll Foundation on the 4th of November will have an event on how can we achieve a ceasefire. We are going to pool the different perspectives on Syria. We are going to organize a respective event. We will also have an exhibition here that will show photos of the brutal crimes committed by the Assad regime. Because here in Germany, it has become clear that this is a global phenomenon. Everybody obviously focuses on IS crimes, but only a few people make clear that the 250,000 people dead and the millions of people that have escaped to others, to other countries, did so because of Assad. And we want to make sure that the crimes committed by this regime are disclosed, although the situation is very complex, especially when it comes to who is negotiating with whom and where and when. We're going to make our contribution, especially when it comes to peace and ceasefire negotiations. We try to make sure that women who have organized in Syria or here in the opposition will participate at the peace tables. I would like to thank Ali, Gloria, Jumana. I would like to thank all of you for your stamina, for your patience, and for your interesting statements, although these are really sad issues. Thank you to the audience for your patience for this long day, and thank you for the interpreters for their patience and for their ability to establish communication. So applause to the three panelists. Thank you very much for coming.
Bei Gitti auch nochmal, danke.
And thank you to Gitti, by the way. Okay, bye bye.
Thank you so much.